Okay, bing on mother's crutches. All right, people, welcome to main lesson. This week's main lesson, it's an online lesson, and we are going to pick up where we left off with last online main lesson. So in your table of contents, you want to write Hitler's downfall, and the date would be 4/8/19. So this main lesson is also an online lesson. There's two questions that I want you to respond to in the drop boxes. The one question will be towards the beginning, and the other question will be towards the end. So if you recall last week's main lesson, we talked about the two-front war now that Hitler was fighting, and we talked about the turning point battles of Stalingrad and D-Day. So starting here, if you take a look at this cartoon, you can see Hitler, and he is being spanked by Joseph Stalin. Screaming and crying. And this guy in the background is President Franklin Roosevelt. You guessed it. And of course, now after D-Day, the Americans and the British are coming from the West. That's the United Offensive. And it says, save your tears, Adolf. That's just the preliminary warming up. So today we're going to learn about how Hitler is not going to be able to withstand all of these big three coming at him at once. So the first question for your online assignment, if you were President Franklin Roosevelt during World War II, would you do anything you could do to win the war, including bombing civilians? So a civilian is, you know, non-military, non-soldier. We're talking just ordinary people like you and me, even women and children, even infants. Would you do as anything you could to win that war, including bombing, killing civilians? I want you to make sure you explain, so don't just write yes or no. Justify your answer and explain to me what you mean. That'll be your first question for the Dropbox, all right? Okay, if you want to create a graphic organizer, you can, or you can bullet this, but we have five reasons basically for Germany's defeat, or we could say the Allied victory. And we're going to go right around the circle here. And the first reason is going to be location, location, location. If you recall back to the First World War, that was Germany's big downfall. They were in the center of Europe, and they just could not continue to fight that two-front war. Well, now they're going to be fighting actually on three fronts, Soviets to the east, and you've got now the Americans and British coming from the west after D-Day, and you've got Americans and British coming up from Italy to the south, and he's got a put troops down there to help his buddy Mussolini out. So Hitler is going to be getting hit from all sides, as you can see in this cartoon. So that's a huge reason. Another reason is that Hitler, being the totalitarian ruler of Germany, took complete control of the military. And he's going to make some really poor military decisions. Probably the biggest mistake is not just invading Russia, but then going after Stalingrad. The city he really didn't need to take, and he just, out of stubbornness and pride, he wanted Stalin's namesake city. And as you learned in the last lesson, he lost an entire army, and he never was able to recover after that huge defeat. Another one is that Allied bombing seriously is going to limit German production and what we call civilian morale. So we are going to bomb Germany into the Stone Age. I mean, it's just going to be daily bombing of cities. Every major German city is going to be leveled. After the war, you're not even going to be able to recognize Germany. It's going to look like the landscape of the moon. And how can you produce tanks and weapons if your factories are on fire and burning? So we limit their production. In the meantime, we're producing. How we do this, we do it with something called incendiary bombs. So you can see the plane there dropping all of those bombs. Those aren't just bombs that explode. Incendiary bomb means fire bomb. So these are small bombs, and what they do when they detonate is that they release this jelly-like substance called napalm, and it burns at a very high temperature. So what we did is we dropped all of these bombs on the center of the city at once. And what does heat do? It rises. Intense heat rises very quickly. So as that heat rises, all of this oxygen rushes in to take the place of that vacuum, and that creates hurricane force winds. So you have animals, humans, cars, anything that can be blown by the wind is being sucked into this inferno. And we did this intentionally. This wasn't just, you know, by accident. We tested this, and we then turned it on live targets. So this is going to kill a lot of civilians throughout Germany, throughout Italy, throughout, especially in Japan. You guys can see in that, I want to write that down, Dresden. Dresden was one of the cities in Germany. It was basically the most beautiful European city. Its major export was pottery. I mean, they didn't even produce weapons. We bombed it. Why? Because we could, and because Churchill wanted revenge for the Blitz. And we ended up killing 40,000 civilians, many women and children. We Americans firebombed Tokyo and took out 100,000 Japanese, more than when we bombed Hiroshima with the atomic bomb. So these firebombings are going to be very deadly. You can see they not affect, you know, soldiers are going to die, but mostly they're going to be civilians here. All right, and the last reason, Italy causes Germany more harm than help. Even though Italy is an ally, Hitler is constantly having to redirect his troops down to North Africa to help out Mussolini, and then Greece to help Mussolini out. And you know, this is going to delay the invasion of the Soviet Union by a month. Originally, he wanted to go in May, and then he had to go in like mid-June. And think about it. If he goes in May, he captures Moscow before the winter sets in, the war's over. So this potentially cost Hitler the entire war, having to help out Mussolini again and again. And then we have the enormous productive capacity of the United States. What that basically means is that we, during the war, were an industrial powerhouse. We were producing tanks and airplanes and battleships. Those 19 little battleships we lost at Pearl Harbor, we produce hundreds more after that. You know, we weren't getting bombed. You look across the world, every major city was getting leveled except us, because we have the Atlantic and Pacific Ocean. Planes at that time could not fly that distance and reach us. So our factories never were hit, and we were able to outproduce everybody. And you see the cartoon, Uncle Sam with the wrench, and you know, our factory smoke is getting in the eyes of Mussolini and Hitler and Hirohito and the Japanese emperor. Okay, so those are the reasons for the defeat of Germany. And then this is all going to come to a head in April of 45. These three leaders are not going to survive this month. Now, Roosevelt, the president of the United States, he dies a natural cause, a brain aneurysm. So he doesn't die a violent death. But remember, he had been the president since 1933. So when he died, the country was really at a loss, because he was one of the most beloved presidents. And we thought, well, how are we going to finish this war without, you know, like our star quarterback is gone now. How are we going to finish this war? So there was a sense of a loss with him. Now, the other two are going to die violent deaths. And Mussolini, by the end of the war, his people are just, they're sick of the war. And many of the communists now are getting back into power, and they're wanting revenge against Mussolini. So that's Mussolini hanging upside down with his mistress. They were trying to escape. They disguised themselves as peasants, and they were caught by a communist brigade, and they were tried and executed by machine gun fire. And then what happened next was really brutal. They took the bodies to a gas station in Milan, and they strung them upside down. And for the entire day, hundreds of people paraded by and pelted them with rocks and clubs. And I mean, it's vicious. That's not just Mussolini's mistress. There were like a dozen other followers, too. And that's what's left of Mussolini's face after that day. And, you know, there's actually live footage of this. They filmed it. It is pretty gruesome, but this is the footage.
Pictures taken in Milan and only just released here show the last of the Huns to leave that Italian city. They had quite a send-off, too. was in a state of the wildest excitement at about this time, for partisans had just killed Mussolini. The bodies of the ex-dictator, his mistress, and fellow fascists were left lying in the square, and the enraged Italians took the opportunity of kicking them and flinging rubbish on them. Firemen were called in to disperse the mob, who were by now, perhaps a trifle overexcited. The final ghastly scene was the hanging of the bodies upside down outside a petrol station. Well, at least it's a warning to all remaining fascists everywhere.
Okay, so that's the end of Mussolini. Now, while this is going on, Hitler, for the last 3 months, since January of 1945, has been living underground in what's called a bunker. It was an underground fortress to protect him from the Soviet bombs and American and British bombs that were falling on Berlin. What's left of his army is right in front of him there. They're basically boy soldiers. You got Alec Faulkner defending Germany. All the fighting age men have died, so you've got old men and young boys. And I don't know about you, but I don't know if I want to face the Soviet army at 14 years of age. I mean, they're just kids. You can see the photos here. So Hitler does not want to be captured alive by Joseph Stalin. He has killed 20 million Soviets, and he knows if Stalin captures him alive, he is going to be humiliated in front of the entire world. And he does not want a repeat of the First World War, how the Allies humiliated Germany. He doesn't want to see that. So he is going to command his followers in the bunker to burn his body once he commits suicide. So the day after he marries his longtime mistress, they both take cyanide pellets, which is a deadly poison. And he actually puts a pistol to his temple and pulls the trigger after he bites into the cyanide to kill himself. The body's going to be burned outside the bunker. There's a photo right there of outside the bunker just moments after the bodies are burned. When the Soviets get into Berlin, they cannot find Hitler. All they find is a pile of ashes and some teeth. If you go to Germany today, that apartment high rise is where the bunker was. And they have since put a marker, because when I was there looking for the bunker, I think they got sick and tired of tourists, American tourists, trying to find Hitler's bunker. But there's a marker right there that shows you where the bunker was. So this is a film called Downfall, and it is about Hitler's last week in the bunker. And this is the suicide scene, showing what happened here. Now, these aren't Hitler's children. He had no children. That's a secretary who wrote the book called Downfall. She was a witness to it. That creepy-looking guy with the black hair is the Minister of Propaganda. He is going to take over Germany after Hitler commits suicide. And he will also commit suicide. Germany will surrender a couple days after Joseph Goebbels commits suicide. Now, his followers were told, they were given direct orders after the suicide to take the body outside and burn it beyond recognition so that the Soviets would never find it.
Reich Leiter, es ist passiert. Ich melde, der Führer ist tot.
That's Joseph Goebbels' little children, and that's Hitler's wife, and that's the secretary who wrote the book, and that's Hitler's body. Now the Soviets are right outside here. This is the Battle for Berlin, so they're just blocks away. The Soviet soldiers are coming. You can hear the machine gun fire and the bombs. Soviet bombs falling all over the place. Now they gotta try to douse the bodies with gasoline and set them on fire before another bomb falls. Creepy looking dude. Just crazy. That's crazy. White people crazy. Alright, so that is the end of Adolf Hitler. And as I said, they're going to surrender just a couple days after that. So what do we got now? We got this. Mussolini is gone. Italy's out. Germany's gone. Hitler's gone. They're out. But we still got the Japanese. So the war is going to continue. It ends in Europe in May of 1945, but it does not end until in Asia, in Japan, until September 1945. So it's going to continue through the summer of 1945. And then we're going to talk about how the Japanese are defeated into next week. Okay, second question, the online assignment. Write a paragraph explaining what you believe to be the two biggest factors leading to Germany's defeat in World War II. This should be a paragraph response, and you should your notes and textbook for specific support. So make sure that, you know, the SQTR this week, if you read that, it goes right along with our online lesson. Use some support, some details from that reading assignment, as well as your notes to develop your paragraph. All right, ding dong, mother scratches, and we'll see you in class.